Let us pray. Keep us, O Lord, as the apple of your eye. Hide us under the shadow of your wings. Amen.
Amen.
Please be seated. So, as a servant of God and his holy church, one of the things that I am asked most often is about why things sometimes seem terrible. Because they can. They do. We are human beings, and it is our lot in life, it seems, to be a people who stumble and suffer, sometimes despite our good intentions and our best efforts. And as a student of Christ and his holy church, one of the things that brings me great comfort is that we are not the first people who have ever asked these questions. In fact, just the other day, I was reading about the Roman Empire. And let me tell you, the destruction of the Roman Empire and the story about the year 410 AD, when the Visigoths came and completely sacked the Roman Empire, seemed to have a lot in common, and actually a lot worse, than a lot of the things that we read and talk and worry and pray about today. And like any great story of destruction and redemption, there comes into the story a great figure, St. Augustine of Hippo, a notable bishop, very famous for writing the Confessions, which is a beautiful book that I buy copies of and hand out, so if you come to my office, I will give you one. But one of the other texts that he was known for was this brick of a book called The City of God. And it was a remarkable book, not just because it was very large and very theological, and that it in fact would go on to become one of the seminal works in Western Christianity. What was really remarkable about the book was that it spoke of two cities. It spoke of human beings as being resident of two cities. We had the city of man, and we had the city of God. The earthly city of sin and destruction and pain, and the city of God that would bring with it an echo of heaven and the promises of the risen and resurrected Christ. And what was interesting too is that this city of heaven, or the city of God, isn't just talking about something that happens to us when we die. It's not just talking about a place that we go and suddenly there we are with God, and everything that we worried about while we were immortal is no longer a problem. Because in fact, what Augustine said about the city of God was that it was already in breaking into this world that we live in now. In fact, Christians specifically were already citizens of this city of God. So there were earthly rules, and there are earthly laws, and they're important, and we follow them, and we try to keep order as best we can. But at the end of the day, we are accountable to none other than the living, glorious, immeasurable and magnificent God who made us. It's an amazing message, and he wrote this book into this time of history where everything seemed to be on the brink of destruction. In fact, Christians of this time were worried that because they had abandoned the pagan Roman faith, that was what had caused Rome to be destroyed. So there they are in these groups and these churches, and they feel abandoned, and they're wondering if this faith in Christ, this radical transformation, in fact, caused this terrible period of destruction. And so Augustine writes this book, and what he's telling them is that it's not because they believe in Christ that their city was destroyed. In fact, their belief in Christ is what saved them and is letting them continue to spread this message of the gospel at all. In fact, everything, he writes, everything would have been destroyed. Everything will continue being destroyed, but for the enduring mercy of God. Of course, it's obvious how relevant this message is for us today. And you know, it's a great blessing to be in a liturgical church with a liturgical calendar, because everything about about the liturgies of November and December is putting us in the place where we're called to recognize our citizenship in that city of God. And we'll take a closer look at the readings for today, but I want to point out, so we all know that Advent begins on December 1st. And we think of Advent as this time of preparing to meet the baby Jesus at Christmas. And in fact, sometimes we don't even really get a real sense of Advent thanks to the stores and the commercials on television and all of the things that want to tell us that Christmas is already happening on November 10th. Is that today? Yes, the 10th. We have these 4 weeks of Advent, and actually what they prepare us for is not just the shepherds and the manger and the baby Jesus and the story of Mary and Joseph. If you listen closely to the readings throughout the 4 weeks of Advent, what you will hear is a story about not just Jesus and his first coming as a child, but about his second coming in the day of the return of the Lord. They're apocalyptic readings, and we have sort of attendance to them in November. And in fact, the ancient church was brilliant at this because they recognized that there was something that had to take place in our hearts to prepare us to hear those readings about, quite literally, the end of this world as we know it. And so we get on November 1st, our patronal feast, All Saints Day, where we celebrate those great heroes of the faith who have come before us, and we hear their stories, and we recognize that we're not alone. And then the day after, November 2nd, is All Souls Day, where we remember the faithful departed who we will see again in heaven once we have departed this life. And we don't always honor them every day in the church, but if you're someone who does follow the liturgical calendar day by day, you might recognize that the saints that the ancient church chose to celebrate throughout November are saints with particularly compelling stories about living as if the coming of Christ was already at hand. There's a story of St. Gertrude and St. Martin of Tours and these heroes of the faith who are always attentive to the fact that right here, right now, is not the end of the story. And so we have these apocalyptic readings. Today we have several of them. If you'll notice, we have Job, and we have Psalm 17. And actually, I have to point out, so that verse that I prayed at the beginning, keep me as the apple of your eye, hide me under the shadow of your wings. This is prayed every night in monastic communities at the office of Compline before retiring to the great silence and to bed. And the verse after it actually is, Lord, give us a peaceful night and a holy death. That's something that monks and nuns for centuries have prayed every day, for a peaceful rest and a holy death. Something we keep in mind that might be frightening to the world outside that sees death as the end, but for someone who dedicates their life to the service of God, it is nothing but a message and a verse full of promise. So here we are in the midst of the drama, the midst of this deeply theological drama, and it's not just pointing us toward the resurrection of Christ. I think this is the blessing. It's not just pointing us to the resurrection of Christ, it's pointing us to our resurrection too. These readings prepare us for not only a transformation of our lives, but a transformation of the way that we understand the world to be. What is earthly will pass away. The manger, the Christmas carols. But what is heavenly, what belongs to the living God, will endure forever. Now, if this sounds a bit complicated, or if this sounds a little bit strange to us, we're in very good company. If we actually meet the gospel today on its own terms, we'll see that it's a friend to those of us who have some questions. So I'd like us to just take a moment and look back. We're in Luke chapter 20 today, but to get context for the story, it's important to take a look at the broader picture. And so we look back to chapter 19, when Jesus and his disciples finally enter the city of Jerusalem after a very long journey. The last few weeks have led us through the Gospel of Luke, and if you've been with us on a Sunday or if you've been paying attention to the readings, you might have noted, or it might have felt like, St. Luke has been describing a journey, the same journey, for 10 long chapters. We begin this journey to Jerusalem in chapter 9. It's the story of the Transfiguration, you might remember that, where James and John and Peter go up to the top of Mount Tabor, and suddenly there Jesus is, and his entire face is transformed with the glory of the heavenly kingdom. And they get this glimpse of who he actually is. They get a glimpse of the living God in this person that they've recognized as their savior, but maybe not quite to the extent that they'll need to get through the trials that come in the next chapters from St. Luke. And so they get this gift of sorts, a grace, a moment of peace and glory to remember who it is they follow. And after that, we'll note that the text says Jesus turns his face toward Jerusalem. He already knows where he's going. He already knows what's going to happen to him there. And 10 long chapters later, Jesus reaches the outskirts of this city and gazes upon it and weeps. He asks the disciples to bring him a donkey that has not yet been ridden. And he rides down into the city upon that road covered in palms and garments, that story that we read on Palm Sunday. And so Jesus comes into Jerusalem, and he begins to teach there. He comes into the boundary of the temple, and this is where we find him today in chapter 20. Now it's important to keep in mind just a couple of things about the Jerusalem temple. The first is that the temple is not just a building. We read the word temple now, and we understand it almost like we might a church. But for the Jews who worshiped there in this first century, the temple was the meeting place of heaven and earth. It was almost their own city of God in a sort of way. It was almost a sacrament by itself. This temple was the place where God dwelled. And it was a place that existed beyond the normal regulations and laws and senses of time and space that would order the rest of the world. And so the next thing to remember is that those who ministered in this temple, the priests, were not just teachers or leaders or elected officials. They occupied this particularly holy and sacred place, set apart to serve at what were functionally the gates of God. Their authority was divine authority. And to oppose them wasn't just to oppose the law, it was to oppose God. So Jesus enters the courts of the temple, and he begins to teach. And what he says begins to bump up against some of the teachings of these temple priests. He shares their faith, he shares their tradition, but he starts to say new things, dangerous things, different things, scandalous things. Imagine if I got up here in this pulpit and started preaching something that made you not only very uncomfortable, but not entirely convinced that I'm not a criminal. I certainly hope that's not the case. But it's hard to overstate exactly how radical this was. And it was a very, very, very tricky situation for the people who were in charge. In fact, they begin to question him. They try to trick him. They try to trip him up. Actually, all throughout chapter 20, this instance we meet in the gospel today isn't the first instance where these groups of teachers are trying to trick Jesus. There are actually a few instances of trickery happening before we even get here. And so if they catch him preaching falsely, if he does not respond appropriately or in the right way or according to the right law, they might not just kick him out of the temple, but in fact might be able to arrest him or have him put to death. The Sadducees ask him a question, and we get that apparently odd little detail, don't we? The text spells out that these questioners are Sadducees, bracket, who say there's no resurrection. And this is important. The Sadducees were a group of leaders known for their ties to the temple, and they were known for their sort of high society roles, but they were also known for believing that there was nothing after death. They believed that the soul is not immortal, and they believed there was no life after you finished this one. And they ask him this weird question. If a woman is married to a man who dies, and then she's married to his brother, and then he dies, and then she's married to another brother, and he dies, etc., for 7 times, whose wife will she be at the resurrection, Jesus? It's a loaded question. Even as we read it, even in the Greek, we get the sense that this is a loaded question. Because not only do these folks not believe in the resurrection, they're also testing Jesus' obedience to Jewish law. Because this practice of a widow marrying her deceased husband's brother is in the Bible. It's in Deuteronomy. It's in the Torah, those first 5 books of the Bible that the Sadducees considered to be the one and only law according to which they should lead their lives. And so if Jesus gives the wrong answer, he could not only be kicked out of the temple, but put on trial for false teaching. So what does he say? He says, those who belong to this age marry and are given in marriage, but those who are considered worthy of a place in that age and in the resurrection from the dead neither marry nor are given in marriage. Indeed, they cannot die anymore. He continues with this very surprising explanation, because instead of answering the Sadducees on their own terms, he's breaking open something new. Marriage belongs to us now, yes, here on earth, and it's blessed. But in the ancient Near East, and sort of actually in its own quirky iteration today, marriage was considered to be the way of essentially ensuring that you would live on. You would have children, presumably, and your name and your lands or your business, they'd continue. And that was how you would persist after you died. But Jesus doesn't offer a clever response that tells the Sadducees they're asking the wrong question. He tells them they're thinking about things in the wrong language. They're thinking about things in the wrong dimension. For Jesus, asking this question is like arriving at the gates of heaven and asking whether or not you left the lights on at home. And in his own very sweet, very Jesus-like way, I love this. I think this gets missed by the story, but this is just so Jesus. It's so precious. He includes the Sadducees in his response. He's not condemning them. He's not just telling them that this promise of salvation is for someone else. He's careful to speak to them in their own language. Listen to this. To these teachers and priests who take only the Torah as their law. That's it. He responds with the story of Moses and the burning bush, a story that they knew. He connects the God of the resurrection that he is telling them exists in another dimension, but he connects this God of the resurrection to the God of Abraham and Isaac and Jacob. And that's a refrain in Jewish prayer and Jewish texts and storytelling. The God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. He's telling them, this God that you know, that you love, this is the God that I am. This is the God who has a promise for all of you. They too are included in this promise, if only they would listen. This is a vital lesson for us. Listen to that last verse again. Now he is God not of the dead, but of the living. For to him all of them are alive. They're alive. In this human life, we're constantly face to face with the agony of decay. Like that story in the beginning, we're constantly faced with the destruction of whatever it is that might be our own empire. From the moment we're born, we seem to be bound by these laws of sorrow and illness and fear and need. No matter who we are, no matter where we live, no matter what time we live in, whether we're married or given in marriage, we seem so limited by so many things. Our bodies, our sins, the things we're afraid of. But if we only think of these things, we're thinking in the wrong language. We're thinking in the wrong dimension. In his resurrection and the promise of coming again, Jesus gathers in that human free fall toward decay and redeems it. He defeats it. He resurrects it. And this isn't just beautiful theology. This isn't just St. Augustine. This is what's true. In this life, we will know suffering. We will know what death looks like. We will know in our bones what death feels like. And it might feel like the end of everything. But this isn't who we are. This gospel text invites us into a recognition that this isn't who we are. It's not what we're meant for. We are not meant for the earthly city. When Jesus took our sorrow and our sin upon him, and when he died on the cross, and when he returned in glory, and when we saw that the tomb was empty, he lifts the veil between the earthly city and the heavenly city. He lifts the veil on our hearts and welcomes us forever, now, tomorrow, and into eternity. He welcomes us forever into the imagination of God. This means that our burdens on earth, however real or pressing they might be, are not what define us. We ask these earthly questions, don't we? We ask, how will I overcome this addiction? How will I reconcile with my spouse? How will I pay my bills? How am I supposed to know what to do with my life? And Jesus hears these questions, and he embraces them, and he provides for them. But he also gathers us gently into his arms and assures us, that's not who you are. That's not what you're meant for. You belong to my city. You belong to the city of God. Because we're not among the dead anymore. The readings throughout November and December will remind us of this, and I invite you to pay attention to them. Because we are not dead anymore. Even the people among us who have passed over into that heavenly kingdom are not dead anymore. We move through the city of God, and it is always a city of life. As Christians, we're called to remember that heaven is our true home. We begin to see this inbreaking of God's glory, this inbreaking of the kingdom of God as we occupy this place of citizenship in another more heavenly, perfect, and glorious place. This may feel like a very grand, impossible thing, but the gift of the church is that it teaches us that it's not. It's the simple and most natural thing in the world, and that's what you're meant for. We see it in the sacraments. We see it in the people we love. We see it in things of beauty, in things of truth, in things that are just. We see it in the moments where something happens and we get that sting behind our nose and we clench our fist and the wind flies into our hair. We recognize that there's something about being alive that's very important. And this is where we're reminded to whom we belong. Pay attention to these ordinary, beautiful things. Love them. And when the world surrounds you with decay and sadness, remember your citizenship in the city of God. It's not just beautiful theology. It's what's true. It's the homeland of grace, and it's where our Savior will come again in glory. Amen.
Amen.